Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. It's so good to be in the house of the Lord one more time. Hallelujah. It's so nice to see you all. Some of y'all are still quarantining in place. Come on, hurry up. I know the state is talking about us going back into quarantine again. But let's just pray real hard so we can get back and be in this building together. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So we can worship him in spirit and in truth together. Hallelujah. 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 This has been an interesting week for me as I have been in this study that Pastor Carter kind of invited me to do together. And it was just been so interesting because in this study now we're talking about obedience to God and how there's a connection between obedience and loving him. Now I must admit I'm a little stubborn and sometimes a little hard-headed and he brought it to me in the natural. He was like, you know that your favorite kids are the kids that do what you tell them to do. Amen. Your favorite kids, the one that when you know you don't have to watch them. You tell them what you tell them once and they get it done. Those are your favorite kids. And you know, I gotta work on being God's favorite. Because it also says that he punishes those who are disobedient to him. So he's chasing them. If he loves you, he gonna put you over his knees sometime. I don't really want no whoopings from God. Sometimes I think, am I getting whooped right now for my disobedience? So I'm up here and I'm supposed to be kind of doing the service today. So y'all kind of bear with me. This is my first time, but y'all know I tend to go. I just want to thank him. Can I thank him just for a little bit? Can I thank him? Lord, you are good. You've been so good. Lord, you are good. You've been better than good. I can't thank you enough. I owe you my life. Can't praise you enough. Even if I try, 'cause you've been so good. You've been so good. You've been so good to me. Hallelujah. I know I don't deserve it. Hallelujah, but you've been so good to me. So I'm going to enter into his gate with thanksgiving. Hallelujah. And to his courts with praise. Hallelujah. I'm going to be thankful unto him and bless his holy name. Hallelujah. Because you've been so good. You've been so good. You've been so good to me. Hallelujah. Been so good to me. Hallelujah. 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 Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, first of all, we give you honor and glory because you are the great I am, because you are Abba Father, because you are the God who heals, because you are all present. Omnipresent. You are all-knowing, omniscient. Father God, you are the great I am, the Lord of lords, the King of kings. Hallelujah. We thank you, Father God, and we honor you, Father God, on today, a day that wasn't promised to us, Father God. We thank you. We pray, Father God, as we touch and agree, Father God, in the spirit, that you would visit us, touch down, Father God. Give us a touch of your love in the name of Jesus. Father God, touch those of us who are at home, Father God, and ailing, those of us who may be sick, Father God, heal right now because you're the God who heals. For those of us who might need something, Father God, you're Jehovah Jireh. Father God, you're the provider, and we thank you, Father God. Now touch the service, Father God. Give us a word, Father God, that encourages us and pushes us to change, Father God, because it takes change, Father God, to follow you. And so we thank you, Father God, right now in the name of Jesus. I pray, Father God, for the hearts of the people, Father God, that you would make us joyful and glad in you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. We give you honor, we give you glory, and we give you praise because you, Father God, are worthy. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Here in the Living Stone Cathedral of Worship, for those of you who are maybe visiting and you're not here often, first of all, I'm going to say, come on back. And there's a spot where we're supposed to welcome you, but I'm going to welcome you right now. Do we have any visitors in the house? Any visitors? So y'all understand what we're doing when we do what we do. No visitors? Okay, we don't have no visitors. Everybody at home. So y'all know we recite then the 34th numbers of Psalms. If y'all would kind of stand, since we're reading the word, are we doing the word? If y'all would stand, we're going to recite the 34th numbers of Psalms. All right, let's do it together. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Hallelujah. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You may be seated if you can. Hallelujah. Y'all look real good. I'm so happy to see y'all in here today. Ooh. Sister Renata, I ain't seen you in a minute. So good to see you. I start calling out, folk. So good to see you. So our announcements are as follows. Sunday school, every Sunday morning at 8 o'clock on Zoom. Amen? Amen. Y'all can react. That's all right. We can talk. 8 o'clock on Zoom, taught by our brother Henry Burrell. Call the office to get connected with the Zoom information. So if you need that Zoom information, get that link, you can get that from the office. Woman to woman Bible study and prayer and Zoom. That's Tuesday at 10 a.m. Okay, I was going to start clowning right there, y'all. Y'all, the retired people can do that, the retired folk. The rest of us got to sneak on our desk and try to hurry up, try to get it while sneaking on our desk. Maybe we want to come, but y'all retired folk be having it at 10 o'clock. 10 o'clock a.m., right? So Woman to Woman Bible Study and Prayer Zoom is on Tuesday at 10 o'clock a.m. So if you can log into that, I'm sure it's a great study. I know that Reverend Patterson does a good job with that. Our next food bank will be on Wednesday, July 28th at 11 a.m. to 12:30. We helping people, y'all. I believe that Living Stone is like the beacon in the community, amen? We the beacon in the community, so we helping people. So be sure to let people know. Again, the food bank is Wednesday, July 28th at 11 a.m. to 12:30. Now, make sure you subscribe to the Living Stone Cathedral of Worship YouTube channel to receive Wednesday night Bible study notifications, right? Bible study is taught by our own Pastor Rodney O. Rivers and Pastor Carolyn Cooks. You know you can't get much better than that. Pastor Cooks. So for those who are still wanting to get your COVID-19 vaccine, go to myturn.ca.gov to make an appointment at no cost. Now, I know that there are some conspiracy theorists out there that say that this thing is a hoax, y'all, but it's too many folks checking out. You know, I'm going to take my chance. I prayed over my vaccine and went on and took that thing. I took that thing. So now, and not only that, but you know, y'all know we want to get back to normal and get back into church. We don't want to have no mask on all day. But, and matter of fact, they can't never get one to fit. I got a big head. I'm a 2X. So the little thing be on my ear, my ears be, look, y'all going to hurry up and get vaccinated so we can hug each other and so I could take that thing because that thing hurt my ears. So anyway. If you are still wanting to get your COVID-19 vaccination, again, go to myturn.ca.gov to make an appointment at no cost. Now, it's been a while. I took mine in March, And you know, and I'm still good to go. So for those of you who are scared it might happen, I took mine in March. I'm still good to go. I'm still good to go. So I'm just letting you know that, you know, ain't nothing gonna happen to you. You might get a little crazier. I'm already crazy, so you know. But y'all know that by now. Y'all know me by now. Y'all done been around me enough. Help or hope. Hope is help overcoming personal experience. Is an additional grief support service provided by our bereavement ministry. Hallelujah. For those suffering from an emotional loss and would like someone to talk to, if you or someone you know are in need of grief support and would like to take advantage of this opportunity, please call the church office and get connected with someone from our support team. So there's a number here, 661-944-4128, extension 10 or 11. I know that you know, we always say in the church that, you know, you could tell it to the Lord, go to the Lord in prayer, and you can do that too. But we also have someone where you can actually sit down and talk to. So if you need a little help, just kind of helping process some things, you know, you can do that. I used to get free therapy. I used to go to the bus stop and sit down, or whoever waiting on the number 9 going to get the story. That's freak therapy. You just get to say it. They don't know you. You ain't never see them again. You can tell them all the quick secrets real quick, and then you can get on the number 9. Yeah. Help me out with your cell phone. Amen, 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 amen. Cell phone technology is wonderful. We can't even get away from that thing, though. We got that thing the whole time. Okay. If you're an income-eligible renter or landlord who has experienced financial hardship due to COVID-19, visit housingiskey.com or call 833-430-2122 to see if you're eligible for California COVID-19 rental relief. So y'all know we done been through some things, and so I know some of y'all homeowners in here, y'all got a lot of properties, because, you know, we got rich people here sometime. If you've experienced, because of the COVID, if you've experienced, you know, some loss as a result of it, again, you can go to housingiskey.com or call 833-430-2122 to see if you're eligible for the California COVID-19 Rental Relief Program. Amen? Calling all men. Calling all men. See, the men just don't even get it. When you say woman to woman, everybody go, oh! The men, calling all men, the brothers is like, I know you're talking to me. I don't have to. King's Men's Fellowship is every Saturday morning at 6 o'clock a.m. In the morning, a.m., 6 o'clock a.m. in the morning. 6 o'clock. Men, let us come together for fellowship and lay our burdens down at the altar. So we get up early at 6. I'm going to have to start doing that too, because at 6 o'clock I could probably tell a whole lot of secrets, because there ain't going to be a whole lot of us in there. I'm just saying. The retired people be like, I talked to a retired brother the other day, one of my retired brothers, and he goes here to church, and I called him. I said, hey, I just want to know what time retired people get up. He said, well, I've been up since about 5 o'clock. He said, I get up early. I'm retired. I don't want to waste none of this time. He tickled me. Dick Wiley tickled me. Reminder, this Saturday, July 24th, Woman to Woman Ministry invites you to attend. You see, as soon as you say woman to woman, the women go in. The fellas be like, he going to ask us to be somewhere at 6 o'clock a.m. They try to pretend like, if I don't say nothing, he won't think, he think I didn't hear it. Pastor Carter, that's what. Saturday the 24th, Women to Women Ministry invites you to The Making of a Christian Woman, continued. It's live on Zoom at 1 o'clock to 2:30. 1 o'clock to 2, 1 o'clock. To 2:30, that's after lunch. You even got a chance to get your little snack. 1 o'clock to 2:30. So there will be an active group discussion on spiritual gifts with a special speaker, Pastor Carolyn Cooks. And y'all even get a solo. Y'all get a solo from Sister Cora Franklin. 1 o'clock. So mark your calendars for Saturday, July 24th. That's Saturday, July 24th, live on Zoom at 1 o'clock. For more information, contact Woman to Woman at W2W at livingstonecathedral.org. W2W at livingstone.org. Okay? New members class. Amen? New members class will be starting up soon. So for my new members, Cause we need to make room for new members. Amen. 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 We got all this space. Sometimes folk got the whole row. That don't make no sense for us to have this wonderful edifice, this wonderful cathedral, and we all got our own row. Like we can lay down for church. Amen. So we gonna get some new members in here. Amen. Amen. New members class will begin soon. For those who didn't complete theirs before the shutdown or need it started again, please call the church office to be added to the schedule for the upcoming class. Again, let's work on getting folks back. As soon as the CDC says it's okay for us to come in here, let's get some folks back in here so we can worship together. Amen? For people in the virtual world, I love y'all. Y'all come on back. I miss y'all. I miss y'all's face. Come on back. Come on back. After the CDC says it's all right for us to come, get your suits ready. I know, because two of my suits fit now. You understand me? I got my jogger game up during the COVID. I mean, I didn't have belt loose on none of my joggers. You understand me? So I know, but that's okay. Come in your joggers, you know, with the elastic. Come with that. All right? Come with that. So the prayer box is available in the foyer if you have a prayer request. Amen? Amen. So there's a prayer box in the back if you have a prayer request. Be sure to make sure you write that. Make that petition known so that we may pray for you, touch and agree, and pray for you. Amen? Amen. Amen. It's now time for praise and worship. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Get your mind around praise and worship. Get your mind right. Hallelujah. Get your mind around praise and worship. Get your mind right. Because if you get your mind right, then we can move right on into praise and worship. And something miraculous might happen if you get your mind right. If we get on one accord as we worship, get your mind right. Get your mind around worship. Something amazing could happen in here. And that's what I'm looking for. I'm looking for a touch. Hallelujah. I'm looking for a touch. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen.
Hallelujah. Continue to worship the Lord. In everything that you do, worship the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You don't need any music. Let him hear your fruits from your lips. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How wonderful it is that we're back in the house with each other. Hallelujah. 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 Lord, we bless your name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Fill every need right now, God. Hallelujah. It's all about you. It's not about any of us, God. Hallelujah. It's all about you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Whatever is distracting you right now, Lord, I ask that you give them peace, God. Hallelujah, Lord. I ask that you meet every need. You are Jehovah Jireh. You are the provider, God. But right now, we're going to worship you, and you are El Shaddai. You are the great Almighty, God. And so we're going to worship you right now like we're just crazy about you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory. Bless your name, Jesus. Hallelujah. Yes. Come on. Yes. Hallelujah. Yes.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. Yes. Thank you.
Yes.
Glorify your name, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Oh, God. You're El Shaddai, Almighty God. Yeah. Hallelujah. The anointing permeate the atmosphere, Lord. There is none like you, Jesus. None like you. You are El Shaddai. You're holy, God. Lamb of God. Yes.
Only you are God.
Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. You are worthy to be praised, God. Hallelujah. I want to let a rock cry out for me. Hallelujah. I won't let the rustling of the leaves from the wind cry out for me. Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Yes. Hallelujah. Thank you. Hallelujah. Oh, let's worship him, worship him. With the fruit of your lips.
We bless you.
Tell him you love him.
If you provide the fire, I'll provide the sacrifice. If you pour out your spirit, then I will open up inside. If you provide the fire, I'll provide the sacrifice. If you pour out your spirit, then I will open up inside. Fill me up, God. Fill me up. 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 If you provide the fire, I'll provide the sacrifice. If you pour up your spirit,
you provide your spirit.
Then I
would open up inside. You provide the fire, I'll provide the sacrifice.
Let him hear you.
You provide the spirit.
Hallelujah. I will open up.
And I will open up inside. Fill me up.
Let me hear you.
Fill me up, God. Fill me up, God. Fill me up, God. Fill me up, God. Fill me up, God.
overflow. I want to run over. I want to run over. Fill me up till I overflow. I want to run over. I want to run over. Fill me up till I overflow.
Hallelujah. Oh, he's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy. Oh, he's worthy. He's worthy. Oh, he's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy. Hallelujah. 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 Fill me up till I overflow. Hallelujah. I want to run over. Hallelujah. I want to run over. Hallelujah. 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 For those of you that was a little contemporary for you, it might have been a little contemporary for you. Let me give you some. Pass me not, O gentle Savior. Hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. I'm calling, Savior, Savior. Hear my humble cry. Hey, while on others thou art calling. Do not pass me by. I'm calling Savior, Savior. Hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not touch me by. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. I know we have a mixed group here. And sometimes we sing a little too contemporary for you. So I'm going to remind you, though. Savior, Savior, why don't you hear my humble cry? Oh, while on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. Hallelujah. 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 He's in the room. He's in the room. He's in the room. He's in the room. I feel his spirit. Hallelujah. He's in the room. He's in the room. You better catch it. Praise him with the fruit of your lips. You better catch it. Hallelujah. He's in the room. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In the midst of your praise, keep praising him. In the midst of your praise, it is now time, hallelujah, for praise. It's time to praise him in giving. Hallelujah. So in the midst of your worship, in the midst of your worship, it's time, Father God, to give. Amen, amen, amen. Now I want to say that God has been he has been a provider, amen. Amen. He's been a provider, and even in the midst of the pandemic, the bills got paid here at Living Stone Cathedral of Worship. Hallelujah. You all were faithful in your giving, amen. Faithful in your giving. So there are several ways to give. At the end, when you leave, there will be baskets at the door, so you'll be able to drop your envelope in. You can also come on in. You can come in and actually visit the beautiful sanctuary. You can come here and go to the main office. You can drop it off there. You can also tithe and offer it through PayPal. For those of you at home and you still scared to come in, don't be scared. But y'all at home, y'all still at home, get your vaccination so you can come on in. But you can go ahead and do it by PayPal. You can also do it by Zelle. Or you can also do snail mail. You can throw that thing in the mail and we'll get it. Snail mail is what we used to call it. Take a few days to get here. We'll get it by Tuesday. Make sure you sign that thing, though, so we can cash it. Amen. You don't forget your signature. You know what I mean? Amen. So, again, there's several ways to give. You can give PayPal, Zelle, or mail. Or you can just, you know, drop it on your way out. Amen? Amen. So, again, I'm making fun of the fact that the bills have been paid, but they have been because you've been faithful. Hallelujah. That means God has been faithful. Hallelujah. That means your income has not been affected. And for those of you who your income has been affected, you still have made the sacrifice. Hallelujah. And you can't beat him giving. You can't beat him giving, no matter how hard you try. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Whew. Hallelujah. Let's worship him today. Mm. open wide as the sky. We lift you high. We lift you high. Hands up, hearts open wide as we cry. God, we lift you on high. Hands, hands up, hearts open wide as the sky. We lift you high. We lift you hands up, hands up, hearts open wide as we cry. God, we love you.
We lift your name high.
Hands up,
hearts open wide as the sky. We lift you high.
Oh, we lift you.
We lift you high.
Hands up,
hearts open wide as the sky.
God,
God, we lift.
The names fade away.
Yes,
hallelujah.
Yes, yes.
Let all the other names fade away. Until there's only you. Let all the other names fade away. Jesus, take your place. Jesus, take your place. Let all the other names.
Let all the other names.
Your place, Jesus, take your place. Him high. Hallelujah. We lift you on high. Hallelujah. Be glorified. Have your way today, Lord. You're worthy, God. Holy, holy Lamb. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Glory to your name, Jesus. There is none like you, God. Hallelujah. Thank you.
Amen. There's so much going on with so many distractions and so many names we hear, but there is only one name. Song says, let all the other names fade away till there's only you. And that has to be the center of your worship. I've discovered that true worship don't come when everything is good. Everybody's getting along at home. The bills are paid. Job is good. Kids are not acting crazy. But true worship, when there's a storm that comes into your life and you still find it a way to worship and praise God, because you have discovered that worship is not predicated off of what you're going through, but about who he is. And if you praise him because of who he is, you'll praise him all the time. That's why we start off every Sunday, I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. It's not easy, but necessary. Don't always feel good, but necessary. Don't always feel right. And sometimes you might find yourself worshiping all by yourself. But that's where God would meet you. He'll meet you in your worship. And so we're grateful to God that God has brought us thus far. It has not been an easy ride. For many of us, there's been some bumps along the road. This past year and a half has been something else. Many families have been strained. Kids have had to endure, change up how they learn. And the truth be told, not everybody's house is equal. We take for granted that everybody's house has Wi-Fi and internet, but it's not true. Some families are just striving just to put something on the table. And Wi-Fi and internet and cable are extra that they simply cannot afford. And so when our kids are struggling during this time frame, it's incumbent on us to be able to extend help where we can. And so when we're in life's battle, I've discovered that there are two things that happens. God puts the believers to the test while Satan will put you to tempt you. God will test you while Satan will tempt you. There are two different words, two different meanings of tempting and testing, but God tests to reveal who you are. Satan will tempt to destroy who God has already created. Have your Bibles, turn with me to Matthew chapter 4. Matthew chapter 4. Praise God for the little sprinkle we had this morning. And somebody saying, I just washed my car. Matthew chapter 4, beginning with verse Number one. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And after fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. And the tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But Jesus answered, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to a holy city and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone." And Jesus said to him, "Again it is written, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test." Again the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and the glory, and said to him, "All these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." Then Jesus said to him, "Begone, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve." Then the devil left him, and behold, the angels came and were ministering to him. I'd like to speak on the subject, the final exam. The final exam. You may be seated. In the life of every student, the word final exam is no strange word to you. All through our education, at the end of the term, at the end of the semester, the end of the year, there was always given a final exam to put you to the test, everything that you have been learning up to this point. The final exam would reveal what you have learned, would reveal if you have prepared yourself, would reveal if you have studied, and so the final exam should not come as a surprise to you. It should not be new information on the final exam, but it should be a accumulation of everything that you have prepared for up until this point. And so the life of a believer is no different. God allows us to go through a series of tests to prepare us for that great day when we're all face our final exam. And in that final exam, you have to understand that not only will God test you from everything that you have supposedly learned, Satan also would be in the midst of that final exam, and his goal and his desire is to tempt you, to confuse you, to disrupt you, to tell you that you're not who God says you are. For 30 years, Jesus has existed, and for those 30 years, the Bible does not record any time Satan came to visit him, does not record any instances that he had any kind of trouble on behalf of Satan, but I have to believe that Satan was attacking him all along the way, because the Bible says he knew who Jesus was. He knew that he was the Son of the living God. And so you can imagine, just like today, there's a bully on every corner. There is somebody in every job that always gets on your last nerve. And I can imagine that even while Jesus was growing up as a little boy, there was that little rough boy in the neighborhood who always pushed his button. There was the rabbi who never really liked who he was. And all of these were signs that Satan was trying to push his button even before it was time for him to reveal who he was. And so the same thing happens to you today, that Satan will push the buttons. How? He will call somebody close to you, someone who's around you, someone you go to church with, to push the button, to cause you to act like you're not supposed to act. The Bible says we are to reveal and conduct ourselves as children of God, but if he pushed the button way too many times, I'm going to tell you, I don't care how long you've been in church, push the wrong button at the right time. Once you became a child of God, you became a target of Satan. And his goal was to disrupt your life, because just like he knew who Jesus was, he knew the calling on your life too. Oh, he knew God called you to preach. He knew God called you to teach. He knew that you were going to be a businessman or a woman. So everything he could do to disrupt that vision, he's tried to do all your life. And if you just stop and think back about your life, all of the bumps and roads that you had to climb, think about who was in there to destroy you. Some of the worst pains come from within. Some of the worst pains come from within. What do you mean? Well, those that are closer, they're supposed to be close to you. You've heard it said that there's nothing like church hurt. Why? Because you've been vulnerable. You let your guards down. You didn't expect my brothers and my sisters to act or treat you a certain kind of way. You didn't expect them to expose you on social media like they did. And so when it happens, your hurt is like nothing else you've ever experienced. But if you think about it, during the test, God has allowed certain things to happen, not to tear you down, but to reveal the God that's already in you. Satan has a strategy, and his strategy is to tempt. To test means a crucial or a critical examination. The procedure of submitting a statement to such conditions and operations that will lead to its proof or disproof of the acceptance or rejection, while tempting is to entice to do the wrong by promise of pleasure or gain. Tempting entices that which is not in one's power to give. Tempting will entice to give you what they don't have to give. Satan will entice you to give you something, but it's not in his power to give you anything. He owns nothing. He tells you that if you will simply bow down and worship me, I'll give you everything that you desire. I know that he's 6'2", 225 pounds, solid. If you would just bow down and worship me, I'll make sure he comes to your feet. He'll come in the way that entices you. She'll look just like you always wanted her to look. Tall, slim, measurements, all that you thought about in your dreams. And he says, but if you bow down and worship me, I'll send her to your house. Oh, come on, church folk. Y'all don't act like you don't see nothing walking by you in the malls. When he walks by you, you don't take a second look. Come on now. There's a parallel story here of the wilderness. Jesus was taken in the wilderness after he had fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. And it parallels the life of the Israelites as they were in the wilderness for 40 years. And for 40 years, God always kept his word to them. He always provided for them. But you can provide and give people all they want and still they won't be satisfied. Because the word says, I'm sick of this manna. Oh, that I wish we were back in Egypt where we could eat everything we had. And I know we were slaves, and I know they beat us, and I know they mistreated us, but it was all good. When he entices you, he blocks your vision. He disturbs what you actually know, and now you're seeing what is not real. Egypt was never nice to the Israelites, but now he's enticing them. They're out in the wilderness. They're in a place where it takes faith. 2020 put the church, or should have put a church, in a place where it takes faith. God, I can't wait to get back in this house. And there's nothing wrong with that, but God says, what if the door is never open? Will you stop worshiping me? Do you worship me because you can come in the building? Or do you worship me before you even set foot into the building? Oh, there's nothing wrong with being in here. I love being in here. I love the atmosphere in here. I love the aroma in here. But what if the door is closed again? Will you worship me? Will you listen to the words of God, but will you listen to the tempter when he says, you know what? God promised you he would be with you always, but now look, you can't even go into your temple. He promised you that he would always be with you, but look, how are you going to meet your mortgage note next month? All those brothers and sisters who said they love you, but look, they're talking about you behind your back. Is this the kind of God you want to serve? And he begins to entice them. Moses was another parallel because he fasted while he was in the presence of the Most High. And as God began to write down his instructions and his law, he spent time with Moses, and Moses didn't have the time and he didn't have the desire to eat or drink anything. And so here Jesus is in the midst of the wilderness. He's fasting because his ministry is about to begin. He's been here 30 years, but all those 30 years, Satan has tried to push his button, but all have failed. The neighborhood bully, that didn't work. The priests who didn't like him, that didn't work. His brothers who were jealous of him, that didn't work. So now Satan says, I'll deal with you myself. Everybody that I sent to you didn't work, but now I'll deal with you myself because I know who you are. Some of the battles in our life, some of the biggest battles that we will ever face, come on the heels of victory. You just got a promotion and now all hell breaks loose. Y'all remember Elijah? All of the people were divided. Whether they would worship God or whether they worship Baal. And so there was a great division in the body of Christ. And so Elijah said, enough of this division, enough of this divide. Let us see who God is. And if our God is the God, then serve him. If Baal is God, then serve him. So he gathered all of the prophets of Baal together. Then he called all of the children of Israel together. Since you are divided, let's put God to the test. And all of them gathered. Prophets of Baal were confident in their God, although he's never spoke to them, never shown them one thing, never came through with them, never provided one thing, but yet they were confident in a lie. And that's where United States of America is today. We're confident in a lie. God has provided for this country time and time again, but yet it's not enough. Through all the great catastrophes that we have ever faced, God has always been there to deliver us and provide a way of escape for us, but still, that is not enough. So after the great defeat and the victory over the prophets of Baal, Elijah found himself in a depression because the Bible says Jezebel was after him. Oh, so you think you're somebody now. She sent word to him that his life by this time tomorrow will be just like those other prophets that just got killed. And so he found himself hiding in a cave asking God, where are you? Anybody ever asked God, where are you? I'm the only one who's asking God, where are you? When the storm hits and trouble comes all around, I find myself on my knees, on my face, in the car, in the room. God, where are you? I've only done what you're asking me to do, and now you have abandoned me. And God says, son, I've never abandoned you. But there is a test on the table. Anybody ever had to take a final exam? Jesus comes to the river, and John the Baptist is there. John is overwhelmed with who he's seeing because John knows who he is. The Spirit has revealed him to him. The Spirit bears witness with the Spirit, right? But he asked him, he said, I need you to baptize me. But he said, so that the scriptures might be fulfilled. And then when he baptized Jesus, the Bible says the heavens opened. And the Spirit descended like a dove and said, this is my beloved Son. In him I am. Don't you know Satan heard those words and it irritated him. For this first 30 years, I have tried everything I can to disrupt him, to turn him around, to convince him that I'm the one he should be bowing down and worship. And he hears those words that were echoing in his ears. This is my beloved Son. It irritated him. That great victory, on the heels of that great victory comes your biggest challenge. So the Bible says he took Jesus. Spirit took him to a desolate place where there was no one around. He's all alone. He's feeling isolated. He's trying to get close to the Father. He's taking time with the Father. He's fasting and he's praying and he's before the Father preparing himself for the next 3 years of his life. And Satan says, I know you're hungry, but if you are the Son of God, and understand that if, The right context is since you are, not if you are. He's saying, since you are the Son of God, how you find yourself in this wilderness starving to death? You are supposed to be the Son of God, and yet you're here starving, and you haven't eaten in 40 days. Look at all these stones around you. And the stones carried along the same image or the same shape as the loaves of bread. And he said, it would only take a word from you to make these stones some bread. And so you won't have to be here hungry again. when he begins to tempt you, it's not that Jesus couldn't do it, but it wasn't in the Father's will for him to do it. Let me say it again. It was not that Jesus could not do it, but it was not the Father's will that he do it. Why are you saving yourself from marriage? Nobody's saving themselves from marriage anymore. That's what Satan begins to entice you. Who's going to know? Not that it's not in your ability to do it, but it's not in God's will for you to do it. Everybody else is doing it. Why don't you do it? So it begins to entice you with something that's not his to give. Since you are the Son of the living God, why don't you make these stones and make them become bread? The devil's ifs are always contrary. And anytime he calls you something, you can almost say that I'm the opposite. Calls you a liar. Calls you a thief. Calls you a loser. But what did God call you? What did God call you? There's a mood now. Jesus is physically weak because he is every bit God, but he's also human. He hasn't eaten in 40 days, and you can imagine when we fast and we just do fruits and vegetables, we're about to lose our mind. So he hasn't eaten in 40 days, and his body is weak. And so all of the enticements, they become visual. He can see the stones, and they do look like bread. Come on, somebody. The story says he takes him to the pinnacle. He takes him to the highest point of the pinnacle, some 450 feet, looking down. And he can see everything. He's showing him what's not his to give, but he's convincing him that I give all this to you if you would simply bow down and worship me. Because remember, he's still preparing for his test. Everything that he's going through has prepared him for this moment right now. And every hill that you ever had to climb, every stumble, everything that you ever had to go through, God was always preparing you for your final exam. But if you allow Satan to make you forfeit that exam, you don't show up. You stop studying. Why do you start? Stop praying. Stop reading your word, because you become so comfortable. Because I already know what the Word of God says. I don't have to read it every day. I've already prayed for this, so I don't have to talk to God every single day. And so Satan gets you right where he wants you. You're now vulnerable. And he tries to make Jesus do the miraculous miracle, but never the messianic miracle. And there's a difference between the miraculous and the messianic. If it was the messianic miracle, Jesus would do just like he did for the 5,000 plus. That was the messianic miracle. That miracle revealed who he was, but also brought praises to his Father. Satan said, stop giving praises to God and bring it to yourself. People need to look and see who you are. Stop. And that's where the church falls into trouble, when we want people to look at who we are. We no longer point to who God is, but look who I am. I'm an educated man. I've been to school all my life. I've achieved everything that I can because I've worked hard. And so the attention no longer is on God, but is on. And you could always tell when someone's always telling you what they've done. And so Satan's saying, it's time for you to be on center stage, Jesus. You've always been talking about your Father, but what about you? If you bow down and worship me, then I'll bring you the praise and the attention that you deserve. He begins to entice him with what's not his to give. So then the devil took him to the holy city and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against the stone. Don't y'all know Satan knows God's word? Can I say Satan goes to church? Satan serves in ministry? Satan stands behind the pulpit? Satan sings on the choir stand, serves on the deacon board, the usher board. He serves in ministry to achieve his goal, and his goal is to divide and conquer. And so why are the churches today being divided? Because we have allowed Satan in our midst. And while he's in our midst, he's wreaking havoc over all of our churches. Brothers can't get along no more. Sisters can't get along no more. His job, he's achieving everything he's accomplished. And yet he's causing us to be ill-prepared for the final exam. The prince of this world caused the Lord to see visions of his kingdom. And he calls Jesus to look down and say, see all of these kingdoms of the world. I'm the prince of this world. I give them to you. If you do to me what you do to your father, if you worship me. The final exam will reveal who's really in here. Church words would not suffice. Raising your hand at the appropriate time will not matter. Knowing how to shout, knowing how to quote scripture, it won't matter when the test falls on your lap and God says, right now, how will you handle that? Every family goes through a test. Every day is not a lovely death, a lovely day that the husband and wife, the kids, everything is. Sometimes it is, but not every day. And it's during those times that are not the best of days that the tempter will come and say, I thought you said God gave her to you. I thought you said God gave him to you. And you begin to look elsewhere for satisfaction. And that's how he begins to entice, because he knows if he can force you to look elsewhere, he can disrupt and destroy the family. And if he can disrupt and destroy the family, then the vision has been broken and you have aborted your right to what God has already called you to be. Satan knows you've been called, but he's trying to disrupt that. Finally, he says he takes him to a mountain and he shows him everything. I can imagine Satan's chest is now stuck out. He believes that his ultimate plan will work, even though Jesus did not bow down in the desert. Because let me tell you, the final exam is still going on. What do you mean? Well, while he was on Calvary's cross, the word says they passed by him and said, they began to mock him. Look at him. Isn't this the man that says that if you destroy this temple in 3 days, I'll raise it up? Isn't this the man that said he can save others? If he save others, let him save himself. While on the cross, the final exam was still going on. And then finally, when they saw him breathe his last and they took him down from that cross, I can imagine it in my own mind that Satan began to celebrate that he had won the battle, that the final exam that he had aced and that Jesus had failed. And when they took him down and they wrapped him in borrowed clothes and put him in a tomb, I can imagine he called all of his kingdoms together and they began to celebrate because he thought he had won. He thought he had aced the final exam and that Jesus had failed. And so he began to celebrate, but there was a sonic boom that hit that night. And that sonic boom disturbed everything Satan was doing with his kingdom. He could not get to the tomb fast enough when word came back to him that the tomb was empty. And he tried all he could to get there. And I can imagine, just like he showed Jesus all of his kingdom, God showed him in front of the tomb, past, A minus, that he began to succeed, that everything that Jesus came to accomplish, he did. Well, what is he going to say about your life? Your exam is coming up, and one day he's going to say, all pens are down and all papers are turned over. The answers are due right now. The final exam is up. Your life, you have run a good fight. What will he say about you? How will the final exam show on your life and your dedication to him? Even though you've had some hard times, will it be able to say at the very end of your life, well done, thy good and faithful servant? This past year put us all to the test. It put some relationships to the test, not just husband and wife, but brothers and sisters in Christ. Some of us have gotten closer. Some of us have gotten further apart. You have to ask yourself, why are we further apart? Who are we listening to? The test is due. It's incumbent on every believer to prepare for your final exam. And that final exam can never be passed apart from love of Christ and the love of your brothers and sisters in Christ. I submit that if you do not love your brothers and sisters, you cannot pass the final exam. It says, by this will they know that you are my disciples because you have love one to another. You cannot pass the final exam hurting on somebody, hating on somebody, talking about somebody, plotting against somebody, fellow believers in Christ plotting and hating. You cannot and will not pass your final exam. And it's going to come a time that when he calls you in front of him, and you said, Lord, I'm so glad to see you. And he said, I don't even know who you are. I know that you served in my church, but you didn't act like you belonged to me. You lied on your brothers and your sisters, and you conspired against them. You even prayed to me against them. And he says, depart from me, for I never knew you. But I want to hear the words, well done, thy good and faithful servant. I want to be able to see on my exam, A+. That I made it and I passed the course. And then he says, enter in. Church, are you prepared for your final exam? Are you worshiping God and him only? Do you love God just on Sundays? Or do you love him all during the week? What do you mean? Well, when you see that bum on the street, did you look at him with compassion and sympathy and empathy? Or do you look at him down at your nose and say, look at this bum, another drunk? He says, what you have done unto the least of them, you've done unto me. When we're constantly looking down and passing judgment, I submit that we are in danger of failing the final exam because we're not demonstrating the love of Christ to the world that he sent us to. As he took Jesus to the high mountain and showed him everything, he's taken the church to the pinnacle. Not that we may show them who we are, but we may show who God is and everything that we do. The final exam is due. Pens down, papers over. Stand to your feet. And when he calls and says, your pens are down and papers over, there's no more time to write. There's no more time to prepare. There's no more time to say, I'm sorry. The hour and time will be up. And that can happen at any moment. That can happen before this day ends. That one of us, he will call and say, pens down, papers over. Your time is up. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for. God, thank you for loving us as much as you do. Thank you for your patience towards us. Even when, God, we act crazy, God, you're still there to love us and provide for us and to forgive us of our sins. But God, if the truth be told, many of us are not ready for that final exam. We've been procrastinating. We've been filling ourselves, thinking more of ourselves than we ought to think. And in doing so, God, we have not, and we are not prepared for that final exam. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, God, we confess our sins right before you today and say, I'm sorry, God, I have not been what you've called me to be. I'm sorry, God, that I have not been preparing myself as I ought to. I have not loved my brothers and sisters as you have commanded me to do so. And I've allowed the enemy to come into my life and to disrupt my life and to blur my vision. And in the process, I have talked about my brothers and sisters. And not only have I talked about them, I've talked about them publicly. I've even convinced others to come with me, to conspire alongside of me. And God, I confess that before you right now in the name of Jesus. And while we were playing games, Satan has entered into this house. And he's wreaking havoc. And now that the time will be up soon, God, I pray for forgiveness of all of our sins. I pray that, God, we will begin to prepare again for that test. That we will begin to conduct ourselves in a manner that is pleasing to you, that we will love one another as Christ has loved the church. Even those that don't like me, God, you commanded me to love them. Reconcile. Help us to reconcile with our brothers and sisters that we have learned not to like and grown not to love, that one day we'll again be able to say, I love you and mean it. God, I ask for this in the name of Jesus Christ. Is there anybody here today who, quite honestly, the final exam has caught you off guard? You have not been preparing as you should have. You've gotten comfortable in your own world. And if he calls the exam today, you don't believe that you're ready to pass it. But let me say, the fact that you're standing here today means there's still time. If you're here today and that you know that you are not ready today, but you're ready to begin the process again, would you just raise your hand and say, pray for me. I am not ready for that exam, but I want to be. And I know the process starts within my heart. I see your hands. I see your hands. Pray for me. I see your hands. I see yours. Final exam is not nothing to play with. Our lives are not nothing to play with. This past year and a half should have taught us something, that life is precious. Thousands and thousands of lives were lost as a result of a virus. But still, we went about our business doing what we do and how we do it. Still no empathy, still no compassion, still no love. Still the same enemy, still the same friends. And all the while, we allowed Satan to enter in. And he has blinded us. So, Father, I pray for those that did raise their hand. And acknowledge the fact that, God, if the test was given today, that we would not be prepared. So, Father, I pray in the name of Jesus, first of all, that you forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And fill us with the Holy Spirit, God. God, we want to hear your voice again. We want to feel your presence again. We want the anointing to flow again in our lives, in our homes, and in our businesses, in our schools. God, we need you. We cannot make it without you. God, allow us to see the difference and know the difference between being tempted and tested. Allow us to hear your voice and not his voice. Allow us to see his tricks and his tactics. Allow us to see how he confuses the mind. But allow us to hear your word and know that what you promised, God, it will come to pass. And so for those that did raise their hand, God, I pray that you would continue to strengthen them and speak to them even today. Show them and remind them of who they are again. Remind them of who you call them. And whatever Satan has called them, God, they know that it is a lie. Allow them to know that Satan can't give them anything. He has no power over them except the power that we give him. And I pray that we will stop giving him power in our lives, power in our homes, power in our businesses, and power in our physical bodies. Many of us are suffering physically because Satan is destroying our bodies. But this body is the temple of the Holy Ghost that he has no power or authority of unless we grant him that authority. So, Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that we begin to take our rightful places, to be who you called us to be, to act like we belong to you, so that we'll be prepared for that day when the words sound out and echo out the corridors of history. All pens down, all papers over, the exam is over. I thank you for them, God. I pray for them that they will hear the words and they'll be glad to hear those words because they'll be prepared for those. In Jesus' name, amen. Is anybody here who just need prayer? Not saying you're not prepared for the final exam. You just need prayer because life has been a little rough for you right now. Life has been hard for you right now. And that is no indicator that you're a child of God or not. Everybody goes through hard times. I don't care how long they've been in the church. Everyone goes through hard times. If you're going through a hard time right now, just a hard time, whether it's financial, physically, your marriage, whatever, you're just going through a hard time and you just need some prayer. Would you just raise your hand? I'm going through some difficult times. I need you two to come here. And for those, I see your hands. I see your hands. Amen. For those that raised your hands, you didn't come, I want this married couple to come here. For those that raise your hands, you can come if you like. Thank you. You're just going through a hard time and just need some prayer. And I don't know nobody, anyone, who at some time in their life don't need prayer. In the beginning, the Bible tells us that God created man. And in that creation, he also created woman and commanded them that they would become one. But the deceiver, the enemy, Satan, came in the midst and got in between them. And he caused havoc in their lives. They gave him permission. Don't give him permission. Sometimes you have to block out the voices around you. That means friends, family, and listen to the voice of God. If God joins you, let no man come between you, no woman come between you. Every marriage is not perfect. There is no perfect marriages. But there is a better one. There is something that it can cause you joy, that when you see one another, joy floods your soul again. It can rekindle the fire that was there before if you allow him the space to do so. And you have to give him space. You have to be vulnerable to him and say, Father, I need you. I want my wife. I want my husband. I want to be one. I want to be happy. And so it requires persistence on your part to block out every other voice you hear. The song that says, let all the other voices fade away, all the other names fade away. It's incumbent and imperative on any marriage to let the other voices fade away. It's good to have family. It's good to get good advice. But if that advice does not match his advice, you have to let it go. I'm going to pray for you that you will hear his advice. Seek his word, and he will restore. He promises that he will restore if you let him. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, pray for this wonderful couple. God, restore, rekindle. Light the flame again. Melt pride. Allow them to see you and allow them to see this, each other as they really are. And they may see that no one is perfect, not even them. And not just look at the other person's imperfections, but look at their own. And so, Father, I pray that that fire begin to light even today. That the love, it would not just be in their lips or on their lips, but in their heart, and that it would be expressed outwardly. That when he looks at her, he sees a queen. And when she looks at him, she sees a king. And we see one. And when the outside world looks at them, they only see one. The one God brought together. So, Father, I thank you that not even the devil in hell could separate this couple. Because, God, you brought them together. You ordained them. You made them one. So, Father, we thank you. We thank you that their future is brighter. And we thank you, God, that there is joy that's being rekindled. And I thank you that wherever they go, there is a flame burning. And we bless your name in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. God, we thank you. God bless you. God bless you. God bless this wonderful family. God bless this family. God bless this wonderful family. God bless this. Oh, bless your name. Bless your holy name. Bless your holy name. Come on, saints, y'all should be praying. Bless your holy name. Bless your holy name. Bless. There can't be any doubt. Because I sense doubt. There cannot be any doubt. God has no doubt in you. He knows you well. He created you. He made no mistakes in creating you. He called you to be something special. You cannot doubt what he says. Don't listen to the enemy. Listen to him.
He called you. He created you. He blessed you, and he's going to elevate you. Listen to him. Listen to him. Block out all those other naysayers. Bless his name. God, thank you for your souls. God, thank you. Thank you. There is no one like you, God. There is no one like you, God. God, we praise you. God, we thank you. That, God, it is not an easy task to be a young person today. So many different enticements, so many different things available to them. But God, you are the same God. And what God, you have called her from her womb, from her mother's womb, to be somebody special. God, I declare and decree in the name of Jesus that the devil and hell will not prevent this from happening. That as she continues to grow and mature, God, you will create within her a strong woman, a woman of influence, a woman that will attract other people and will help those to overcome what she has overcome. And that she will point them not to herself, but point them to Jesus. And allow them to know that he's a safe line, that he's a shelter, that he's a provider, that he's a lover. He's a creator. And just as he has blessed her, he will bless others. So God, I thank you for what you're about to do in this young lady's life. Now guard her, protect her, surround her. And surround her with people that has the same convictions that she does. And reveal to her those that have no good thoughts about her. Reveal to her her true enemies are. Those that will smile on her face and talk behind her and her back. So God, reveal to her her true friends. And show her who her enemies are. That she might be well equipped and prepared for the task that is before her. And we give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. God bless the Lord. Sister Gooden. Come over here, brother. Come on over here. Speaking of going through something, this couple has gone through something. They've been through some physical challenges, but look at where they are today. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. It appeared at times we weren't going to be here, Deke. But here you are. It feels like that even now, sometimes. But one thing I've learned, Satan is not the giver of life, but God is. And as the one and only who provides life, listen to his words. Until he tells you that your task is over, it is not over. Until he tells you that your ministry is done, it is not done. Continue to trust him. Even when you're sick, even when you go back to the hospital, don't allow the surroundings of the hospital to dictate your fate. It is yet another opportunity to prepare you for your final exam. So, Father, we thank you for this wonderful couple. Thank you for what you have done in their lives and what you are doing, and God, for what you will do. God, speak to them today to allow them to know that their fight is not over. Their job is not over, so their lives are not over. Continue to push them, continue to stretch them and grow them. And God, I pray that you use their experiences to help others. When others feel that they can't go no further, they will begin to minister to them and let them know that there is no place that they can go that God will not be there with them. So, Father, use them. And now, Father, we pray for healing of their bodies. For all of the issues that they have experienced and are currently experiencing, God, we know that you are a healer. And there's nothing that you cannot do. So, Father, we pray for strength in their bodies to be able to accomplish the work that you've called them both to do. We give you praise for them in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, amen. You may stand to your feet. Pray for our country. Not praying for further division. Not praying for one group and not the other. But we're praying for our country because this is our home. And so we want an environment that is conducive for those, for everybody to be equal, to be on the same playing field. And so we're praying for our country not to be further torn apart, but to be driven apart. And the only way that will happen is through, first of all, the body of Christ. Once the body of Christ is united, then the world will follow. It does not work in reverse. The world is not to follow the world. The church is not to follow the world, but rather the world is supposed to follow the church's example. Let your light so shine that others may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Now to him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before his presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power both now and forever. Amen. Go with God.